Welcome to this video. And in this video, we'll start the discussion on measurement of electrical quantities. And specifically for this video, we'll be looking at measurement of voltage and current. So we look at the voltage and current measurement. Any measurement system must meet some essential requirements. And these requirements are as follows. Number one, the introduction of the measurement system into the circuit where the measurement is to be carried out should not alter or change the circuit condition. In other words, the introduction of the measurement system should not change the existing circuit condition. Number two, the power consumed by the measurement system for the operation should be very small. In other words, for the operation of the measurement system, they should not consume high amounts of power. Instruments for measurement of voltages are called voltmeters, whereas instruments for measurement of current are called ammeters. We'll start with a discussion on the voltmeters. Voltmeters are connected in parallel with the circuit where the voltage is to be measured. So if you have a load and you'd want to measure the voltage across the load, the voltmeter is connected in parallel with the load. If, for example, we have a network, where this is our load and this is our source. The voltmeter is connected in parallel with the load. The power loss in the voltmeter is given as follows. Power is V squared over RV, where V is the voltage indicated by the voltmeter, and RV is the internal resistance of the voltmeter. The internal resistance of the voltmeter. For their operation, we said that the introduction of the measurement system should not alter the circuit condition and they should draw minimal amount of power. Therefore, for the power consumed by the voltmeter to be very minimal or very small, we notice then that the electrical resistance of the voltmeter must be very high. In other words, RV must be very high, or the internal resistance of the voltmeter must be very high so that the power consumed in the voltmeter is very small. Number two, for the ammeter, which is the instrument used for measurement of current, ammeters are always connected in series in the circuit whose current is to be measured. So if you have, again, our load connected to a source of supply, where this is our source, then the ammeters are always connected in series. So we would connect the ammeter in series as follows. And through this, we are able to measure a current that flows in the network I. The power that is lost into the ammeter will be given by power is equals to I squared RA, where I is the current detected by the ammeter, and RA is the internal resistance of the ammeter. You notice we would want this power to be very small, and therefore the internal resistance of the ammeter must be very small. In other words, ammeters are fabricated with very small internal resistances so as to ensure that the power consumed in the ammeters is very small. We look at the configuration of the basic DC ammeter and voltmeters. We look at the configuration of the basic DC ammeter. For large currents, the major part of the current is required to be bypassed using a resistance called a shunt. And the basic structure of a DC ammeter is as follows. So we have total current I. This is a shunt resistance, R subscript SH for the shunt resistance. A current flows in that network, I shunt, and a current flows in the meter, IM, the current through the ammeter. The internal resistance of the ammeter is RM, and we are saying that this is the basic meter. From this, we notice that the shunt resistance and the ammeter are in parallel, and therefore the voltage drop across the two is the same. In other words, we can write I shunt R shunt will be equal to IM RM, where RM is the internal resistance of the basic meter and IM is the current detected by the meter. We can write R shunt as the subject of the formula, which will be IM RM over the shunt current. But from our circuit, we notice that the total current I is the summation of the shunt current and the meter current, from which we notice that the shunt current is the total current I minus the meter current. And therefore we can write the shunt resistance to be IM RM divided by the shunt current, which can also be written as I minus IM from this equation. If we divide both sides by IM, then we can write these as RM over I over IM minus 1. We define the ratio I over IM to be the ratio M, and M is called the multiplying factor. And therefore, our shunt resistance is given by RM over M minus 1. The value of the shunt resistance required in the ammeter will be given by the internal resistance of the ammeter RM over M minus 1, where M is the ratio between the total current and the current detected by the meter. We can observe that the shunt resistance may consist of a constant temperature resistance wire within the case of the meter, or it may be external shunt having a low resistance. To increase the range of the ammeter M times the shunt resistance required, then must be given by 1 over M minus 1. Therefore, if we want to increase the range of the ammeter M times, then the shunt resistance required must be 1 over M minus 1 times the basic meter resistance. From the equation of the shunt resistance, then the value of the shunt resistance must be 1 over M minus 1 times the resistance of the basic meter. With this in mind, then we can extend the discussion to the fabrication of the multi-range ammeters. Multi-range ammeters. The range of the basic DC ammeter can be extended by using a number of shunts and a selector switch. So you would want to have a number of ranges for our basic meter. We can extend the ranges by having a number of shunts and a selector switch, which is able to select one of the shunt resistance at a time. The configuration of the multi-range ammeter therefore becomes as follows. For example, if you want a three-range ammeter, we can have three resistances or shunt resistances. Where this is R1, R2, and R3, and this is our basic ammeter. Then we have a common switch that we can use to switch between the various resistors that we have. And this becomes the configuration of the multi-range ammeter. It's good to notice that with this, we can have the ammeter be able to read three different ranges of currents, I1, I2, and I3. And in our case, then R1 will be equal to Rm over M1 minus 1, where M1 will be I1 over Im. Similarly, R2 will be Rm over M2 minus 1, where M2 will be given by I2 over Im. And through this, we are able to achieve different ranges of measurements of our ammeter using the shunt resistances R1 all the way to Rn, where n is the number of different ranges that you must achieve for your given basic meter. Next, we look at the basic DC voltmeter. The basic DC voltmeter is as shown below, has a series resistance RS and then the basic meter. This is the configuration of the basic DC voltmeter. The series resistance is called a multiplier. The series resistance is called a multiplier. The basic meter has an internal resistance Rm, and a current Im is going to flow through the basic meter. And this is our basic meter. The main function of the multiplier or the series resistance is to limit the current through the basic meter, so that the meter current does not exceed the full scale deflection value. In other words, we use the shunt or the series resistance to limit the amount of current that flows through the basic meter so that it does not exceed the full scale deflection current. From our circuit, we notice then that the voltage source will be equal to the drop across the series resistance and the drop across the internal resistance of the basic meter, which we can write as Im into Rs plus Rm. If we make Rs the subject of the formula, we notice that Rs will be given by V over Im minus Rm, and the series resistance will be obtained as Rs is V over Im minus Rm. Hence, we can write the drop across the basic meter, the drop across the basic meter as V, which is equals to Im Rm. The drop across the basic meter is Im Rm. And we define the multiplying factor. We define the multiplying factor where this is small v. Capital V is the total voltage. We can write then the multiplying factor M, which is V over small v, given by Im into Rs plus Rm, the total voltage given by this equation, divided by the voltage drop across the meter, which is Im Rm, from which we notice then this is Rs plus Rm over Rm, and this is our M. If we make Rm the subject of the formula, Rm will be given by M minus 1 into, or the series resistance Rs, the series resistance Rs will be given by M minus 1 into Rm. And therefore, to increase the range of the voltmeter M times, the series resistance required must be M minus 1 times the basic meter resistance Rm. And that is the configuration and operation of the basic DC meter. Finally, we look at the multi-range voltmeter. The multi-range voltmeter. And we can observe that the basic DC voltmeter, or the range of the basic DC voltmeter, can be extended by using a number of multipliers and then having a selector switch to choose one of them at a time. So we'd have a number of series resistances sharing a common switch, from which you can be able to choose one out of the very many series resistances. For example, for a three range voltmeter, we can have three resistances, R1, R2, and R3. Sharing a common switch, so you can switch between any of them. And then going to the basic meter. So this is the basic meter with the internal resistance Rm, and a current Im is going to flow in the network. And this is our basic meter, has series resistances R1, R2, and R3, and the overall voltage V as noted in our network. And this is our switch, which we can use to select one out of the various ranges we have in our given network. We have observed then that R1 will be given by V1 over Im minus Rm. Notice from the series resistance, Rs is V over Im minus Rm. Therefore, for R1, it will be V1 over Im minus Rm. And similarly, then we can write R2 to be V2 over Im minus Rm, and so forth. And through this, we can be able to design or implement a multi-range voltmeter with a number of series resistances and a common switch to select one out of the many resistances in the given basic meter configuration. And that is the end of my presentation on the voltage and current measurement. In my next video, I'll be discussing the instrument transformers as used in measurements of heavy currents and high voltages. Thank you for watching the video.